All right, this week on the Million Dollar Plan, I'm Pete the Planner, we're talking college financial literacy, also known as financial wellness, also known as teaching kids about money so they don't do silly things. Joining me to have this discussion is my friend, my colleague in many regards, and my partner on a project. His name is Philip Schumann. We call him Phil Schumann, Phil the Schumann. He is the director of financial literacy at Indiana University. Hello, sir.
Hey there, Pete.
Wait, you're the director of the Department of Financial Literacy?
Just the director of financial literacy.
Okay, no one knows. I actually know. So Phil is here in the studio. If you want to watch this episode, watch it. PeteThePlanner.tv. Phil, you and I, we've been working together for a few years. We finally said, let's formalize this and make it big. Yeah. So that's what we did recently. I'm going to make you talk about it. Go.
Oh my gosh. So we've been working on a project called Money Smarts You for the past, I don't even know how long it's been now. Since October, November, somewhere in there. Just coming out of the idea that, you know, college students need to learn how to make good financial decisions, but the way it's kind of been presented to them up until this point has kind of been, hey, here's all the information you need to know all at once. Go nuts.
Yeah, that's the weird part about it is, you know, my organization, we teach people about money all the time. And you've been in this business now 3 years?
Five years?
Yeah.
I'm practically an adult in this.
You're almost
now.
An adult. There's this idea that, well, we got to teach kids about money. Let's teach them everything. That's actually a really bad idea.
Yeah. I mean, because you're not going to get students to pay attention to stuff that's relevant to seniors when they're freshmen because they're not understanding or they're not to that point where they're starting to think about those decisions. Like, students don't really care about job negotiations when they're freshmen because they haven't had or been presented with that opportunity yet.
Yeah, it's weird. It's like to take a sophomore and say, this is how a 401k works. It seems like a good idea, but it's really not.
No, I mean, it may be good in theory just in terms of getting them to start thinking about it. But the fact is, like, there are other financial things they need to address first before they start talking about 401ks.
So let's back up. Before there was a Department of Financial Literacy at the 10th largest university in the country, which I use 10th, is that right?
I'm going to be honest, I have no idea. It's up there.
140,000 students across...
114,000.
Well, look, I'm not good with numbers, right? 114,000. Before there was a Department of Financial Literacy, what was the attitude around kids and money? And by kids, I mean students.
I mean, really, it's kind of the same that it still is now. Like, I mean, money is a pretty taboo topic. It's rare to find an engaging audience, especially between 18 to 22-year-olds, where you're actively wanting to participate in conversations about money with the exception of, hey, how much money am I going to make?
Yeah, that's true. And I think it became a really big problem when tuition kept rising and rising and rising. There's all sorts of statistics about how much education has risen. I think even in front of Congress, some of those statistics have been given incorrectly, but that's neither here nor there. Was there a crossover point from a year perspective that you think where 1993, college was rising at such a pace and then student loans couldn't cover it anymore and all of a sudden we've got a disaster?
That's a great question. I don't think there was ever a point. I think it's just started becoming a bigger and bigger news story probably after 2005 or maybe even when the recession hit. Like all of a sudden, you know, people were more concerned about their finances and started paying attention more to where their money was going.
That, you know, I never thought about that, dude. I never thought about the idea that the recession had something to do with this conversation. You might be right. Let me get through this. Well, there seemed like there was a lot less margin for error when the recession got here.
Yeah.
You know, people, I think what the general person, consumer, citizen, whatever, mouth breather, doesn't understand is that student loans, by their nature, cannot be, you can't bankrupt yourself and get rid of student loans. What am I trying to say? You can't...
student loans aren't forgiven.
Forgiven,
bankruptcy.
Right. I have no words, sir. So that becomes an issue, right? Because a lot of times if you get yourself into debt trouble, there's a way to get out of trouble by either filing bankruptcy or having your house foreclosed or abandoning the property. Yeah. You can't really abandon your degree and get out of the debt.
It's very hard to do. I have heard stories where it is possible to do, but I think for the most part, it's not going to happen.
And actually, one of those ways is pretty interesting. The strategic default with student
loans. Yes.
And you and I always debate on how much we talk about this because we don't want to suggest it because it's a horrific idea, but it's interesting.
Yeah.
Right? Go ahead.
God, if I can explain it correctly, I mean, basically students, in order to prevent themselves from, like, I
discharged
guess,
debt. Yeah. That's the word discharged. I couldn't think. Gotcha. Discharge. I'm sorry. Very awkward moment in the show's history. Guest is talking ice cream discharge. Sorry.
But I mean, like, strategic default, basically students are just ignoring their payments because they know they're not going to be able to afford them. And so they just continue on their lives. They understand that it's going to hurt their credit and stuff like that. But they feel like that is going to be the pros outweigh the cons.
The other methodology, which is similar to that, though, too, is to use a credit card to pay tuition payments. Mm-hmm. Thus, the debt associated with the education could be dischargeable because you could file bankruptcy on the credit card.
Yep.
Don't do that. But that's a way some grad students were dealing with debt. And it's also, during the recession too, there were working adults who lost their job, couldn't survive, so they decided to go back and take out a bunch of student loans by enrolling in a class.
Yep.
With the thought of, hey, we're just going to have to survive on this.
Yeah, I mean, and it still happens to an extent. Like, I think there are a lot of stories that came out that made it seem more prevalent than it actually was. But that's still a thing, and it's amazing that people will do that. And it's amazing how they, you know, can use the system in order to, I guess, temporarily financially benefit themselves.
So this whole episode, which is what we're talking about, we're a few more minutes here in our first segment, but the rest of the show, we're going to talk about some of the big mistakes college students make, mm-hmm. some of the huge mistakes parents make. I think that's a big part of our messaging with Money Smart to You, is that by parents not having these difficult conversations because they're trying to protect their kids from tough moments, I don't know, they make the problem so much worse.
Yeah.
And that's tough, right? Because at some point in time, we're looking at people and saying, oh, hey, by the way, you're doing this wrong.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, the first course, you know, when we started building this, the first course we talked about was the high school course.
Yeah.
And one of the things we put out there is, here's how you can have conversations with your kids, or here's how the kids can have conversations with their parents to make sure they've got, you know, basically everything figured out once they start funding college.
All right. So Phil Schumann, Director of Financial Literacy at Indiana University. We'll be back after the break. We're going to talk more about the mistakes college students make, their parents make as they try to fund their college education. Tuition rates continue to go up. Some schools are freezing them. Some schools are creating financial literacy programs. Some schools are creating ways to invest in a student and take their career earnings. It's confusing, but that's why we're here. We'll be back in just a minute. I'm Pete the Planner. On the Pete the Planner Show, Million Dollar Plan. I don't know what we call this thing. I'm Peter, and it's a show that I'm on. Thanks for listening. Talking college and money and paying for college with money. Phil Schumann, Director of Financial Literacy at Indiana University, joins me now. So Phil and I, our organizations, entered into a partnership, a public-private partnership, if you will, mm-hmm. to try to combat this issue. So we've built Money Smarts U. It's an online digital learning platform for IU students, and then we're distributing it to other colleges and universities across the country. After it's all said and done, dude, there'll be 21 hours worth of courses on there. This year, there'll be 7 hours worth of courses, and we just wrapped season one, the shoot, as they call it in the biz. It was a long few months shooting those videos.
It was probably easier for me than it was for you, because, I mean, you're the one that has to spew out all the information.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, look, I mean, it's good, though, because I think it's such a horrific topic. I mean, I think that's the challenge. You were talking about that in the first segment here today, is that you're asking 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, 20-year-olds to care about something so heinous and disturbing in the moment in their life in which they're told they're supposed to be having the best time of their life.
Yep.
Those two things don't add up.
No, they don't. And so you see students choosing, like, to just ignore it and just have a good time. And you see some students that prevent themselves from having a good time and trying to be as financially sound as possible. And really, like, part of the reason for Money Smarts U is we want it to fall somewhere in between.
Yeah, so you guys did something in the last few years involving letting students actually know their student loan balances as they went to borrow more money.
Yeah.
And tell us about the impact of that, because I find that to be, like, one of the biggest no-brainers ever, yet it didn't exist until you did it.
Yeah, so, and it's amazing how much traction it's gotten over the last few years. So back in 2012, we implemented what we just called the debt letter, which basically just tells students, hey, here's how much money you've borrowed up to this point in your academic career. Here's what your interest rate is projected to be or about what it is. And then here's your estimated monthly payment after you graduate. And basically the idea behind it is, well, let's try and make student debt transparent to these students. And then hopefully when they see that number, they might be a little bit alarmed to the point where they start having conversations about, well, do I really want to take this amount of money out? Or do I want to figure out a different way to fund my college experience?
And you saw an immediate impact of that. I mean, you're talking a huge impact.
Yeah. So, I mean, since the, and I should say that since the debt letter started and since what we deem like IU's affordability initiative.
Okay.
So this is, you know, some of the things we've done with cost of attendance, the debt letter, our financial literacy office, like since those things have been in place, and that all started back in 2012, the university has seen a decline of student borrowing by $98.7 million, or about 15%.
So, so this is a slippery slope when it comes to, I'm not going to ask the administration's view on student borrowing, but I would guess they want students to be educated. They want them to get their degrees specifically at Indiana University, and they want them to borrow the money it takes to get that done. Yeah. But doesn't this get a little bit weird of saying, we want you to get an education, even if you don't have money, but don't borrow a bunch of money? And I think to some degree, that's why it's taken so long to bring these conversations to light, because of the colleges not wanting to have this conversation.
Yeah, I mean, there are a couple thoughts about that. Like, student loans in of themselves, they're not bad things. I mean, they were created to help people get the degree they need in order to boost their lives after they graduate. And that's still what they're there for. But what we've seen over the course of time is in some cases, like, students just take advantage of it, or they borrow more, you know, because it just goes back to the point where if somebody offers you $5,500 or $3,500, and at that point in time, there's no ramification.
Yeah.
You can just have $5,500 or $3,500. What are you going to do?
$5,500. Give a little wiggle room, a little cushion.
Yeah. So you're going to take $5,500, and that's what we've seen. And so that goes back to the debt letter, just saying, like, hey, basically, we want you to think about what you actually need in school and not what you're actually offered. And if you do that, you'll put yourself in a better position once you graduate.
Some of the big mistakes we see on a regular basis range from having a car on campus as a freshman.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of colleges and universities frown upon that for different reasons, because they know if you don't have a car on campus, retention improves.
Yep.
But from our perspective, the cost of having a car on campus can be astronomical.
It's huge. I mean, that's the thing. Like, if you're a first-year student down in Bloomington, like, basically your car is relegated to the Assembly Hall or Memorial Stadium parking lots.
Right.
Which, that doesn't really do you any good. Like, you got to walk all the way out there to get things. And as you learned, as you were walking around campus, and I kind of prove I have a habit of walking everywhere,
mm-hmm.
it's faster for me to walk anywhere,
right,
as opposed to going to my car, finding a place to park, and then going inside whatever building I'm in. You know, there's not necessarily anything wrong with having a car on campus, but I feel like for your first year or two, like, get yourself acclimated to the university and kind of stay close to it so you can learn what's there, and then you can kind of branch out afterwards.
Other big mistakes we see are the waste of the student loan refund. Which is a student loan refund is a byproduct of how an education is paid for through the bursar's office.
Yeah, I mean, the bursar's office, I mean, basically just, hey, here's the money you get back after we've used your financial aid to pay for everything the university needs.
And we're just going to deposit it into your checking account.
Yep.
Or send you a check. And at that point, Phil, it's raw student loan money that feels like you just won the lottery.
Yeah, and it, like, I remember being back in college. I went to DePauw, and this was back
with a W,
back before you know, direct deposit really was a big thing. And so I just remember a friend of mine getting a check that was for $1,600 in the mail.
Oh, man.
And there's no letter or anything attached to it. It's just, hey, here's this check for $1,600. We went out and had a good time, because there's no indication of where that money's coming from.
And the parents often don't know that's happening.
No, my parents had no idea that I probably got like $100 or $200 back.
Yeah.
They had no idea.
And what's crazy about that, and this is where we're going to sound like two old guys talking about this, which turns out, Phil, we are. Oh, I am, you're not. Let's say you go and buy a cheeseburger, right? Oh, it's delicious, and I just bought it with a student loan refund. Well, now you're going to amortize that cheeseburger over 10 to 25 years. And that's a really expensive cheeseburger.
Yeah. I mean, that's we try and teach students that that's what's in, what's happening. Basically, you are paying for something over the course of 10 years. And it was just a like an innocuous cheeseburger that you had on a random Thursday.
Isn't it, I know you feel this way, like we walk the line when we talk to college students of being a killjoy at all times.
Yeah.
I mean, I always am a buzzkill. But when you talk to college students, again, it goes, time of their life. Hey, man, don't you spend your refund check. And they're like, I'm 19. I don't care. But the ramifications are gigantic. You're talking about delaying buying your first house, delaying getting married, delaying being able to buy a car, to move out of your parents' house. And that's a big part of this issue, too. Almost 40% of non-students 18 to 34 years old move back in with their mom and dad or live with their mom and dad still. And so that's an epidemic.
Yeah. I mean, that's a huge epidemic. And especially, I mean, obviously there are two buckets you can fall in there. We do have some students that strategically move back in with your parents to save up money, which is fantastic.
We love it.
We will encourage that to no end. But yeah, the ones that just graduate and have no plan whatsoever and kind of just mooch off mom and dad for an extended period of time, like that is becoming more and more of an issue. We've got to figure out how to address that.
We also, I always say we, but it truly it is you and me. We also believe that students should work up to 15 hours a week while they're in school to pay for their living expenses. And studies show working 15 hours a week actually increases a person's GPA.
Yeah, we think that's just because of like the time management piece, that you're learning good skills that are kind of helping you figure out, all right, this is how much time I can devote to academics, how much time I can devote to work, make a little bit of money. We're in good shape. But what some of the research shows too is that, you know, if you work more than 20 hours per week, your GPA is likely to decline, and it's going to take you longer to graduate. Whichever year the longer you're in school, you know, you're going to be paying more money. And so we see that. So we try and encourage students to work 10 to 15 hours a week. But the research also shows that 40% of students are investigating working more hours because they feel financially stressed.
Yeah.
And so that's a huge problem. We've got to tell students, like, you are trying to apply a Band-Aid to this problem, which is not going to help you. Like, honestly, if push comes to shove, I'd rather you take out a little bit more in student loans, get your degree in as quickly as you possibly can, get out, and then start making the, we'll call it relative big bucks.
Yeah, relative is an important word there. I think our worst case scenario and our nightmare that we try to avoid and help students avoid is when a student is so stressed financially, whether it's self-induced or involuntarily feeling stressed, that they drop out.
Yeah.
They say, I can't do this. And so they have an unfinished degree with a ton of student loan debt, and it is unrecoverable in many instances.
Yeah. That's a huge problem. You know, what we've seen a lot of universities do, which I think is great, is they've started opening up different programs for these types of students to keep them involved with the university and help them out. There's a community college over in Ohio that has put together a program that helps students apply for like community benefits or community assistance. And they do that through like trained students that help them apply for these things. So that way, if students are feeling stressed because they can't afford like food, or they've got a child and they need help looking after it, like they've put them in touch with community agencies to help them pay for that stuff, because they don't want them to leave, because obviously the worst situation you can be in is graduating or having student debt and not graduating, as opposed to having student debt and graduating.
Well, what we're going to do, we're going to take a break, and we come back after the break, we are going to talk about how this impacts parents. Sort of the forgotten entity of all of college education is the impact on a parent's finances. And what we found and what we're trying to fix is the impact of parent plus loans on someone who's trying to retire in a couple years. So we'll talk about that when we're back right here in the Million Dollar Plan. I'm Pete the Planner. All right, former presidential candidate, and by candidate I mean he didn't make it through the Democratic primary, Martin O'Malley has over $339,000 in Parent Plus loans. I mean, he borrowed money for his daughter's education, and after they capped out the amount of student loan debt they could take. Vice President Pence has six figures of student loan debt on his kids, and I would say when two people of that ilk have that much student loan debt for their kids, we got a problem. Phil Schumann's back, director of financial literacy at Indiana University. Your title's really not too long. It's good. Right length.
It's not bad. I like it. It's better than some of the previous titles that I've had.
Yeah, or what people call you.
That's true, too.
So I have to think, if a student doesn't understand the impact of a student loan refund and how that can hurt them, I'm convinced, and you can't convince me otherwise, although you feel free to try, parents have no clue on how much Parent PLUS loans are going to impact them negatively for the rest of their life.
I think we'll say the majority of parents do. Okay. There are a couple out there.
Can we go with vast majority?
I would be okay with that.
It's a big deal.
It's a huge deal. And we've had some stories over the last few years of interesting things that parents have done to negatively affect their future for the benefit of their children's, which is a noble thing. And if a parent does that, like, I will never like say they're a bad person. That's a great thing for them to do, or it's a very nice thing for them to do. But the reality is, and I know you're big on, you know, funding retirement and getting ready for retirement, like, you are sacrificing your retirement for something where your student or your child will be able to pay it back, even if it takes 40, 50 years. Like, that's okay. Yeah. Or at least that's better than you sacrificing yourself or sacrificing your retirement. Because when you run out of money in retirement, who do you turn to?
Your kids.
Right.
And so if they have no money.
Yeah. And so if they're not in a good position to help you out, then this is just all bad news.
I think a lot of it is there's this, people think, just because you maybe went, one went to school in the 1970s or 80s and you bootstrapped your education, you worked your way through school and you paid for it yourself. And that's the same experience you want your kids or grandkids to have. That's cute, but it just doesn't work that way.
No.
You just can't do that. So if you want to make a kid have it be all on them, here's your choices. You can either pre-fund a bit of their education so that the math will work. Or the second thing you can do is make sure they're going to school cheap enough that they can afford tuition.
Yeah, I mean, the pre-funding thing is huge. And I can't remember if we talked about this before, like, or where
probably.
We exactly know this, but I know we've talked about it, but I can't remember. The numbers that we always use is, if you, between 0 and 18, you pre-fund $40,000 worth of education, you know, it'll be worth $80,000 by the time the kid goes to college.
Right.
Perfect. So you can fund $80,000 of college for $40,000, mm-hmm. or if you take out loans, it's going to cost you $97,000.
Yeah.
Simple math, I would rather pay $40,000 for $80,000 than $97,000 for $80,000.
I think another interesting part of that same idea, especially as it relates to parents funding an education with loans themselves, let's say we've got a scenario, and this sounds super judgmental, but I always almost sound super judgmental.
I think you're allowed, though.
Let's say you got a student who you did not pre-fund their education. You want your kid to go to school. You did not pre-fund any of it. You have no money. And so your kid has to borrow. Your kid caps out at the amount of student loans they can take out by law. So then now you step in and borrow on their behalf. Well, let's say the same sort of entity that would create a situation with no pre-funding, the same sort of parent and personality would have no pre-funding, conceivably could also have poor credit. And if they have poor credit, then those Parent PLUS loans aren't going to be at 6%. They're going to be at 11%.
No, they'll be closer because since they're federally protected or whatever, it's when you get into the private loans that I think things get a little bit more dicey.
Absolutely. So I misspoke. So that's what I meant. On the private loans, they range based on your credit.
Mm-hmm.
And so that creates a lot of issues because you have one person who thinks, well, we'll just borrow and figure it out later. But because of their mentality, because of their credit, they're in trouble. Thanks for my back there.
I don't want to get that information out there. I mean, because when push comes to shove, we'd rather a parent take out a PLUS loan as opposed to a private loan. But the situation or the reality of the situation is we'd rather you not do either.
Yeah, and that's where this gets almost controversial, right? Because we're saying, well, we don't want you to borrow too much. We don't want parents to borrow. We don't want kids to go too expensive a school. And then people say, well, what are we supposed to do? Go to a community college? And I don't say that disparagingly, but that's the feedback we get. It's like, hey, take it easy. And to some degree, Phil, the least expensive schools are those more community college-based schools or mm-hmm. even a, what do you call your satellite campuses or alternate campuses? I mean, what do you call in your other campus?
FRIU, the regional campuses.
Regional campuses. I knew there was a term.
Okay.
I mean, but they're less expensive.
They're less expensive. And realistically, yeah, there are some programs that are better, but they are just as good. And there was actually, and I can't believe I'm going to say this on a thing that's broadcast to the world, there was a great study that was done in part by Purdue a couple of years ago that basically said that, you know, with the exception of a few schools, like, where you go to college doesn't matter. Like, it matters what opportunities you create for yourself. Like, and that's the important thing. So we've got students that are coming from out of state for, I mean, realistically, no reason other than they really want to be Hoosiers, which is fantastic. But we, you know, if you are like, if you grew up an hour away from the University of Illinois and you have the opportunity to go there, Illinois is a fantastic school as well. Like, and this is part of the whole Money Smarts You thing here, is it's not necessarily to try and push people to come to Indiana University. We'd love to have you. Bloomington's a phenomenal town. You know, the rest of the campuses that we have throughout the system are fantastic too. But really, we want people to make good financial decisions, because if people are making good financial decisions, that's better for the entire economy.
All right. So I'm going to ask you a question that makes you feel like I'm going to make you speak for the administration. But from my understanding, mm-hmm. that if an out-of-state student comes to a university, the margin mm-hmm. on that student is much higher mm-hmm. for the university itself. Mm-hmm. Yet we want students to make good financial decisions. So how in the world, collectively as a university, do you get your head around the idea of, we want people to make good decisions, but by the way, if you're prone to make bad decisions only on finances, we'll take that extra margin?
Yeah, so I can pretty much just kind of pass this question along and just say, like, I'm not administration. My job is to teach people to make good financial decisions. I'm not going to have a 100% success rate.
Yeah.
And so we will have students that will come in from out of state, which is fantastic, and we love the diversity that it brings to the
right.
university. But, you know, for those students that are in state, we really want them to make good decisions, because obviously we really care about the Indiana economy, and we want to make sure that it's those that are involved here are making really good decisions that don't hurt them later on in life.
What's the difference? What's the difference in cost at IU Bloomington for out of state?
Boy, you're putting me on the spot with this one.
It's like 10 grand difference?
The in-state, when you look at the cost of attendance, I know this number off the top of my head. It's $24,808 in Bloomington.
Okay. In-state?
In-state. Out of state, I want to say it's somewhere in the around 40.
Okay, so we're talking about a $100,000 four-year education versus a $160,000 four-year mm-hmm. education.
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean,
it's a 60% difference. I did that math myself.
It's a huge difference for the in-state students. Like, one of the messages we always promote to them is that if you look at the cost of attendance, you know, everybody's up in arms about tuition getting higher, which will not discount that ever. Like, that yeah. is a thing, and that's something that universities are trying to fix. But if you look at it, like, there are five buckets for cost of attendance. There's tuition fees, room and board, books and supplies, personal and transportation. Tuition and fees makes up about 42% okay. of Indiana, of going to Indiana University's costs, which means that room and board, books and supplies, personal and transportation, AKA things that you can control
right, totally.
To a certain extent. Like, you control 58% of the cost of your college. So if you make good decisions, yeah, that tuition is going to be there, but then you can lower the rest of those costs and get yourself a degree for cheaper than that $24,000 that's being thrown out there.
All right, let's take a break. We'll come back with one more segment with Phil Schumann, Director of Financial Literacy at Indiana University. You're listening to The Million Dollar Plan. I'm Pete the Planner. We're back on The Million Dollar Plan. I'm Pete the Planner. Joined by Phil Schumann, Director of Financial Literacy, Indiana University. Special Money in College edition?
Sure. That feels special.
We got to do a BWOM, though. Biggest Waste of Money of the Week. This one is submitted by my producer, Brie. Brie, hey, Brie.
Hi.
So you bought a screaming goat.
Yes.
And I'm going to play the goat sound now. I think people just, that's the sound of people turning off the show, Brie. Why did you buy a screaming goat?
I just love it so much. I was so excited.
How much did you pay for this?
I spent $10 on it.
Brie.
Yeah.
This seems like a big waste of money.
This is what you pay me for.
I feel like that should just be a Happy Meal toy, right? That's the value of it.
It's excellent.
Are there screaming goats?
Yes. Goats, they do scream sometimes. Like, they faint, you know? It's just a thing that goats do.
This is, these are the things I don't know. All right, so thanks, Bree, for the you're screaming welcome. Goat. Phil, aren't you glad you're here?
Absolutely, I love being here.
All right, Phil, tell us as we wrap this week's show, tell us about Money Smarts U. What do we do?
So Money Smarts U, as you kind of said earlier in the show, like it's all about trying to provide students the information they need to know when they need to know it.
Yep.
So what we're trying to do is, again, as you said, like we're trying to build 21 hours of content of financial information that goes out to students when they need to know it. It's going to be a digital platform, so any student will be able to log in to their account through the university, assuming their university signs up, and learn about information that's relevant to them at that time. So for this first year, you know, we just wrapped up our first round of shooting. We've done courses on high school juniors and seniors, mm-hmm. one on first-year students, one's on sophomores, one on juniors, one on seniors, one on those considering grad school, and then one for recent alums.
Yeah. So that's it was fun to shoot, and it was fun to build the program on that need-to-know basis. Mm-hmm. I feel like it was authentic in that approach. Because previously what we found in the financial literacy space for colleges and universities are, hey, you're a freshman. Here's everything you need to know about money through retirement. Yeah. And it's like, that's just silly.
Yeah. And I mean, and there are a couple programs out there that try and help segment some of the things, but I don't think they do a good job necessarily like directing students where they need to go. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm really excited about what we're doing because, you know, basically we're telling students, hey, this is all you need to know for right now. Don't concern yourself with anything else. Then we built a score at the end of each module, our Money Smarts U score, that basically helps students assess their level of financial habits. You know, because we've seen a lot of students that get obsessed with their credit scores. We wanted to take a step back from that and say, that doesn't matter necessarily. Let's have you focus on the habits that you're going to be building that will help lead to a good financial life after you graduate. Yeah,
people love self-assessment. They love quizzes. And what this basically does is it says, are you thinking like you're a freshman? Are you thinking like a freshman? Mm-hmm. Cool. Good. Or are you a freshman? Are you thinking like a junior in high school? Well, you need to fix that. I mean, that's sort of our metric and the basis of understanding of which we pass on. But where that gets really interesting is when you have someone about to graduate in their final year of school, but they're still thinking like a freshman. And Phil, we know that's a recipe for disaster.
Right. And that's the reason, that's the reason why we built the scores, because basically we wanted to help students, you know, lead them to behavior changes. So if we get that senior that has that freshman level score, at least through the scoring system, they can say, okay, if I do this and this, I can improve myself and get myself to where I need to be so that I'm a good manager of my finances after I graduate.
If for some reason you'd like to learn more, just as a listener, go to moneysmartsu.com. That's moneysmartsu, all one word. And by you, we mean U as in university, not Y-O-U.
Yep.
We should probably buy moneysmartsyou.com too.
Probably a good idea. You're just
Bree, can we buy that? Sure. Okay, thanks. So that's it this week. Thanks for coming.
Absolutely.
I've seen you so much recently shooting these videos. Thanks.
I know. Like I said earlier, we started my week with you, and I'm ending my week with you.
Well, that's how it should be. So that's all the time we have this week on The Million Dollar Plan. The screaming goat, it's his last appearance here on the show. We're going to have tacos, I think, with the goat.
It's so, a recurring guest.
It's not.
Yes.
I kind of like it, I'm going to be honest. Show. It is a waste of money unless I end up buying it from you. So that's it this week. I'm Pete the Planner. Thanks again to Phil Schumann. Reminding you, as always, I'm sending you good vibes because good vibes are all that's in the budget. I'm Pete the Planner. This is a Million Dollar Plan.
This is where I came from, planet Lovetron, where we drop love bombs, funk missiles, and live in soul shelters. No helter skelter, the heat don't swelter because everybody stays cool. Left many moons ago to bring the philosophies of my ancestors to another place. God picked the third rock, gave me to my earth family, and told me to create, and so I am. Pen in my hand, microphone on the stand, over vinyl I command and demand. Magnificence in an instance, I can make you dance, cry, or love, fly as a dove, released from Everest, the fresh is fresh, and you can call me E.T., word to John Tesh, let me bless this harmonic presentation, it's amazing, so amazing, I'm the reason, salutations, I bring you Lovetron greetings, from a faraway land, I am the feeling so controlled. Put the remote down and let me take control. You're now a part of my zone, so enjoy yourself. Love Tron can restore your health. I bring you greetings, salutations. How you doing? And is that how y'all say it? The tinkling of the keys is an homage to the little star. I sojourn over poetic descriptions of sound to travel to my other world. Out of this world, spaceship on my arm took me home, filled by the ink and the megabytes and the hypertext transfer protocol, stronger than the Skynet and the Terminator. I push faders into warp speed, glide with ease, creating a breeze they call a black hole. Event horizon, no rear view concerns. This I adjourn, and beats I burn. This I adjourn, and beats I burn. Salutations, I bring you Love Tron greetings from a far away land. I am the sole controller. Put the remote down and let me take control. You're now a part of my zone, so enjoy yourself. Love Tron can restore your health. I bring you greetings, salutations. How you doing? And is that how y'all say it?